Welcome back to the 5-7 podcast. I'm your host, Mike Pree, and today I have on the podcast, and we are going to be talking about life of a cadet and some police stuff, because there's a lot of police stuff going on out there that, seems to be a narrative that, the police are all bad, and I want to bring it out to everybody that they're not. So, Carlos, welcome to the show.
Hey, I appreciate you having me, man.
How you doing?
So far, so good. Can't complain too much.
Can you, just give us a rundown, like where you're from, the whole deal?
Yeah, so born and raised Northwest Indiana. Obviously, I've known you for forever and a day, right? So not too many secrets as far as personality, so you can probably speak more on my my past, right, and kind of where I'm at right now. Big family, Northwest Indiana. Lived out there till I was about, it's going almost on 10 or 11 years now.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah, it's been a while since I moved out to Northern Virginia. So came out of here, started a personal business, worked, simultaneously in retail for a long time, and really wasn't fulfilled in what I was doing. So I made a drastic choice, I guess, in my career path, and decided to go into law enforcement. I don't think anybody saw that one coming, something I've always wanted to do. Currently I am in a police department here in Northern Virginia. It's one of they consider a prestigious police department. I got an opportunity. I got in. Took about a year to get in, year and a half almost, with all the background checks, and currently on a new path in my beginning stages of getting into law enforcement right now, which is a crazy time, as you can probably tell. I get a lot of questions as to why, and do I really want to continue with this? And there's just some crazy stuff I can tell you here in a little bit. My life has changed drastically within the past couple months since starting the academy, and kind of how things have progressed as the narrative's been changing in the nation. So it's a weird time, man, for sure. But it's still something I want to do, and it's I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have in regards to it. So, man, it's definitely. I feel like anytime I get into something, though, it just, that's kind of my luck, right? It's like the shin in the stick. It's nothing pretty when you go into it, head first. And this is definitely one of those times, especially changing career paths. And like, I've done retail, retail management, everything about that for 20 plus years. And to get into law enforcement, especially now, it's just, it seems crazy. But like I said, it's something I want to do, and I'm going to see it through.
So. When did you start the academy?
So I started it in March. So the beginning of March is when it officially kicked off. And it's like a paramilitary style. It's everything you think a boot camp would be. It's crazy. Crazy. So, but I started in March. I have about a month left, month and a half left until I'm in the field. But right now it's a 6-month program with them. It's 40 plus hours a week. It's crazy, like the objectives we have to complete in order to move on. It's not as easy as people make it seem. I thought it was, what I assumed getting into the police department would be just like, hey, you got a clean background, everything's good. If you're not pretty much a dick bag, they look into it, and then they'll give you a badge and a gun and throw you on the street type thing.
Right.
It's kind of intense. You go in there, they have tests, they have guidelines that you must meet. If you don't meet those guidelines, they'll cut you loose. It could be as simple as a test question or like scenarios. They put you through a scenario, and if you can't get that shit right, they'll say, sorry, man, this ain't for you. Have a great life. They'll cut you loose. So.
You know, that's good because it kind of weeds out some of the people that shouldn't be there. How long would you say the, you said it took you about a year and a half to get in. What is the entrance process like? Because, you know, nowadays I think there might be, you know, people, just to give people an idea of what it's like to get in.
Yeah. So it was a long process, to be honest with you. I, for whatever reason, I second guess myself. I'm like, one, you gotta be a certain age. You gotta be up to, I believe it's 36 where I'm at. 36 is the cutoff as far as maximum age when you apply. That doesn't mean that they'll cut you off. I mean, if you have other skills and assets, they'll consider it. But more likely than not, you got up to 36 years. And then you apply. So basically, it's just like a paper application like anywhere else. They have a lot of information that they ask. They're very detailed as to what they want to know about you. You're basically giving them an entry to your past, man. So nothing's off the table. The paper application process, I think I went through that. I didn't hear back from them for about maybe a couple months. And then they told me, like, all right, here's the next step, basically. So you go through a series of, they put you in contact. You really don't have a personal contact. It's not like an HR group, you know what I mean? So it's not like one person. So there's different divisions of the police department that cover, like you have a background investigator, but that came later on. So I guess the first steps is you go in, you do a drug test. Once you do the drug test, you have to do a physical assessment to see if you're physically fit to handle kind of what's coming at you. That was a pretty kind of grueling thing. They strap like a 20-pound vest on you and make you go through this obstacle course. You had to complete under 8 minutes. Once you successfully completed that, then you moved on to a medical exam to make sure that you're like kind of fit. And then you do a lie detector test. You kind of go through that and they basically ask you everything and anything. You do a psychological exam. So you, it's like 600 or 700 questions, to see where you're at mentally. And then you talk to one of their like clinical, basically a shrink. They analyze everything about you. So they'll ask your past, if you had any thoughts of hurting yourself, any thoughts of hurting somebody else, you know, how you feel about taking someone's life. Kind of, they analyze everything, but see exactly, are you looking to go and just hurt somebody, or are you just, you're here basically, why do you want to be a cop type thing? So the psych eval was there. Once the psych eval passed, they gave you to a background investigator. And the background investigator, they asked you for references. And I think it's hilarious because you give them all these references and the way they work, it's you give them the references, they'll call that one person, be like, and then they ask that one person, well, who else does he know? And they go through a backdoor channel, right? They don't use your references for a means of, they know you're going to give them the best people that are going to say, hey, yeah, this guy's great. But they don't look for that. They kind of look behind the door, like, who else does he know? What's their phone number? You know, they went to my neighbors. Like, I didn't put my neighbors down. They knock, hey, have you seen any, like, domestic abuse or anything like that? And they ask them questions, like, straight up. Because they can't even tell me. They're like, hey, man, police department came in asking about you. You know, they asked me if you're kind of a douchebag or not. You know, I'm like.
Did they say yes?
Yeah, I think a couple of them, no.
It's too bad they didn't call me.
Yeah, no, I was like, thank you. I was like, I'll put you on the list, too.
Yeah, that's why they didn't call me.
Yeah, I'm kind of glad. The only person I left out was Salinas. I feel like he's just bad news.
Yeah, he is. He was supposed to be on. He was supposed to be on the podcast tonight, but he had a few other things he had to take care of.
Of course.
Okay.
But no, they checked around and they did like an intense background. Finally, when I heard from them, that cleared. It took a little while, and then they said, "All right, well, you're gonna meet with so and so." I met with a couple of the officers, did another interview. Then I had to wait again. And then they called me back and said, meet with the captain and see what's going on. At that point, they offered me, but that was a long process. That was like a year and a half. So nothing was fast.
So a year and a half, you're doing this. You get to the academy. Everything starts up. And then in the middle of this, things start going crazy. At what point in your training were you when the George Floyd thing took place, when he was murdered?
I mean, so many crazy shit happened. The COVID thing happened, you know, and there was about 54 recruits when we first started. COVID started, and then we went down just because people failed out of different things. So we were at 43, 44. And then all of a sudden, you know, the George Floyd thing hit. And then when the George Floyd thing hit, it was, God, we're already close to halfway through the academy. So yeah, about close to halfway through.
What did your supervisors or your instructors, did they give you like a block of instruction on what's happening, or did they what happened in the training process?
So we were, it's kind of funny because we all were talking about it as it happened, because obviously we all had to watch the news, and there's a lot of different personalities in the academy. There's a lot of different people, and it's very diverse, and you have every kind of, you know, type of politics in there. So it's obviously a point of discussion, especially when it comes to police officers. The one thing that everyone had in common is, you know, obviously how and what happened. So it was a big topic of discussion obviously when we went in there. You don't really talk about it because obviously, well, I mean, you would know, just like in the middle, you don't say anything. People walk in, it's very like hush. It's the instructor or, but this day, the lieutenant, the major, the captain all walked in, and which is very rare to see that much brass, you know, walk into a classroom and they're like, hey, look, this is what's going on. They showed us a video of it in the academy. So we're sitting there and they didn't say anything. They just turned on, they let the thing play in its entirety. We're listening to everything, listening to obviously the whole situation going on, the officers, the whole nine yards. And they're like, we want to know what you think about it. Like, what are your thoughts on that? Because they had their opinions, but they wanted to hear what we thought about it, which I thought was pretty cool because, you know, they're like, this is law enforcement. This is what, you know, people are doing that affect everyone. What's your guys' thoughts on it? And everybody was kind of, you know, they were kind of disgusted by it because it was, everybody felt the same. Like, that was not appropriate. It definitely set everything back. And, you know, it was just unfortunate, right? No one was really, like, sticking up for the officer as far as, like, what happened. And then the captain came in, the major came in, and he's like, look. He's like, the moment you stop seeing people as human beings is the moment that you need to stop being in this academy and the moment you need to stop being an officer. He's like, because it doesn't matter about, you know, nothing else matters. If you're going out there to prove a point to yourself or to somebody else, you're in the wrong line of work. They're like, we're not in that. We're in the people business. And if we can't get in there and, you know, handle situations as crazy as they may seem, you know, they're like, it was just unnecessary use of force, you know, and they're like, it's going to come back down. And that, he was right. He's like, it's going to come back down to his training. They're going to focus on how we're training officers, what are we doing, and it affects us. They're like, how we train you in here, they're like, is what's going to come out when you're on the streets. You know, they're not going to question you for anything else but your training, and if that's what they taught you to do and how your response is to that, you know. So it was like very somber. I think we talked about it for about 2 hours, an hour and a half, 2 hours, and the major was just going in. He was just like, you know what, it takes this much more to be a pro, you know, just a little bit more to be a pro. And it's just the situation, I think it was unfortunate because it set back law enforcement easily about 10 to 15 years. Because to be quite honest, before that, when the COVID hit, they were like, you know, first responders. Hell yeah, you guys are out there taking care of shit, handling business, and yada yada yada. You know, mainly people in the medical field, but you know, first responders, cops were out there still handling calls every single day,
still patrolling and that kind of thing.
Yeah, they were still patrolling, doing the whole nine yards, and they were getting a lot of, you know, kudos. And George Floyd hit, and it kind of set back law enforcement as a nation back for quite some time. It's going to be a big hurdle. It's going to take a while. Not like, but it happens. I mean, it's in cycles. You know, 9/11 hit. You know, cops were appreciated a lot more. Firefighters, police officers, you know, everybody that was first responders were like put up there on this like pedestal. And then all of a sudden, you know, shit hits the fan, and you know, someone dies, and it's unfortunate, and it's something that no one wants, and it sets back law enforcement back years. And it really just takes one person, man. And that's the sad thing about it. It takes one person, and it really, it's a narrative that people put out there, and when it catches hold, man, it's good. That's it. You're done.
Well, you know, that everybody knows who that one guy is, you know, and it comes to a point where, you know, how long are people going to accept that kind of thing? You know, you mentioned that, I think that police officers need more training. And obviously from the video, they show, the officer with his knee on his neck for 8 minutes. Now, I'll be honest with you, man, I don't see anything wrong with the knee to neck technique to subdue somebody and get them in cuffs. I don't agree with it for an officer to do that for 8 minutes or 2 minutes. It shouldn't take that long, because when you have somebody incapacitated like that, obviously that's what the move is meant to do, to incapacitate people. As soon as the cuffs are on, you know, you should get off the guy. That being said, you know, there's many videos out there of showing police officers on calls, two guys trying to subdue somebody, and that guy overpowers both cops, gets to the car and pulls the gun. You know, actually, there's a pretty famous video of a traffic stop of that happening, and this guy, you know, trying to shoot at two police officers and then driving away.
Yeah, I mean, that happens. I think there's just a lot of scenarios like that that aren't really shared. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because like officer safety is like, you just don't know who you're getting involved with. Like, that's the biggest thing. I agree that like when it became excessive, when the cuffs, basically what you needed to do is get the cuffs on, put them in the recovery position. You had more than enough help there. He had it on them. You should have been off. Like, right. That's the biggest thing. Our training is not, it's to get the handcuffs on, get them restrained, and then put them immediately in the recovery position.
Right.
And the recovery position, for those that don't know, is like, you need to have your diaphragm open.
You need to have it uncompressed.
Right. So
without somebody sitting on you, you know?
Yeah. I mean, that's a big deal. So, and then when your hands are, you know, when you have no way of doing that because your hands are behind your back and you're handcuffed, you're restrained.
And you can't breathe.
And you can't breathe. That's a big deal. I mean, I've been put on the floor several times by a bunch of my coworkers, and you can feel it, man.
Yeah.
Like, if you don't get in the recovery position pretty quick, I mean, it's just like getting choked out. It only takes seconds to get choked out.
Yeah, it doesn't take long at all.
No, and you know, 8 minutes, like, holy shit, like, that's a long time.
Yeah.
It's a long time. And then you got to get, I don't know, I can't speak for anybody. Like, everybody can Monday quarterback every situation, right? Because no one's really been put in a situation. When you're in it and you feel it, it's like, it's a different beast, because your reaction can be seconds, but like I said, it only takes a couple seconds to really knock somebody out, right?
Yeah.
So you got to think quickly. You got to react. You got to still, you know, at the end of the day, you want to go home, right?
Right.
They want to go home too. So it's just, how do you mitigate those circumstances where you're not fucking hitting full throttle and then, you know, you catch yourself catching a charge yourself? I mean, these guys are facing murder charges. I mean, some people, like,
Wow.
And then it's just each like I say, everybody can Monday quarterback these situations all the time, but no one really discusses those situations where, yeah, somebody goes right back, gets a gun, and starts shooting them because they couldn't restrain them.
Right.
Or, you know, and there's plenty of those. I mean, there's obviously a ton of police officers that die in the line of duty every year. I think right now we're at 149 line of duty deaths, you know, nationwide. It's 149. I mean, I don't know the stats of...
you don't see that in the news.
No, but no one discusses it or talks about it because it's not a... One, no one's proud of that. No one's like, hey, another cop died. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it really is about the narrative that no one wants to hear, and especially now. No one gives a shit, to be honest with you.
I don't think that's necessarily true. You know, I don't like hearing about anybody dying. You know, like especially cops that are out there trying to do the right thing. You know, so would you say that, you know, with the training that you're getting, and especially with the George Floyd incident, do you think that has changed your training anyways? Do you think that it's changed maybe the scope or the type of training that you're getting?
So none of the training has changed at all. As far as like they're not changing paths because they don't teach that. Does that make sense? Like the training doesn't need to change, and that's the funny thing about it. Like the department's going through like trying to really focus on less lethal force and de-escalation, and we're getting like crisis management teams in place and like really focusing on resources, but they've always had that. You know, it's just up to the officer to implement that.
Okay.
So
it's more of a judgment call then.
Yeah, and that's what 99% of your calls are going to be. They're all judgment calls, right? You know? You just don't know. One, it can be as easy as, you know, hey, how you doing? Hey, I'm lost. I need to go there. To, you know, it's about to go down. You know what I mean? But the training hasn't changed because it's really, you know, you got to use what they're teaching you. If I was to go hands-on with somebody, my goal is to get them into restraints as quickly as possible with the least amount of injuries. But at the same time, I'm applying the same force that they're applying back. You know what I mean? So if they're going 110, I need to go 111 to make sure that we're, you know, we make it even. You know what I mean?
Sure.
So, but no, nothing's really changed. They don't teach that. They're like, they don't teach you to choke someone out. Right. They don't teach you like to keep your knee on the back. It's literally get in, restrain, and then if you have help or assistance, that's all you need. They teach you recovery positions. They teach you, like, but why ask officers? Like, I know a lot of officers are in the department now that I talk to on a regular basis, and they're like, nah, man, no one shows you how to do that kind of stuff. That's somebody taking it to a different level. That's their unfortunate judgment call because the training that they receive never showed you how to do that. And I don't think it will ever change to show you how to do that. But not to say, like, I've talked to several instructors before, and they said, like, look, we used to do palm strikes to the temple, like, knock them out that way. And they stopped doing that, you know? And then they at one point in time, were doing submission holds, like chokeouts, like, okay, rear naked choke holds, get them subdued, but they don't do that anymore either. So all they do now is apply enough pressure on you to get your hands behind your back and then slap cuffs and then sit you down.
Yeah, the rear naked choke hold's pretty effective if you know how to do it properly.
Properly, right. But then, again, in the heat of the moment...
That's where training comes in. That's where stress-based training comes in, just so that you can get used to it.
And I think they just ruled it out completely. Like, nope, not doing that. And... Is it good? I mean, anybody can debate that. No, I feel like you need those in your back pocket. If you're trained properly on it, I think if you have it in your back pocket in case the shit hits the fan and you can rely on some kind of training like that, and if you're trained properly and you practice it, then at that point, you can rely on your training and go from there. But in this kind of climate, man, I don't know if that's even, you don't even want that in there. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Where do you go from here?
As far as like when the academy's
done? Yeah, as of now, you're like, you know, where are you moving on from in your stage of training right now? Because you said you have a little bit left, right?
Yeah, I got a little bit left. It's actually not too much more. A couple more exams. And then, God willing, I graduate in August, and then I move on to what's called an FTI period, field training instruction. And then I would be doing that for 3 months before I'm quote-unquote cut loose on my own. Mm. And then kind of just go from there.
Okay.
Yeah. It seems pretty simple, but I mean, there's a lot of training objectives that still need to be met.
Right.
Prior to me even getting to graduation. So I'm taking it one day at a time, man, because that shit's intense.
Well, it's an important thing to do, because I think that's guarantees success. Because if you're thinking about 2 weeks ahead of time, you know, you're forgetting about what's right in front of you.
Yeah. No, yeah, that's 100% sure. Like, yeah, that shit's insane. Like, I stopped thinking about graduation. I stopped thinking about all that stuff. All I know, I just need to get past Monday.
Yeah.
Monday, I need to get past Tuesday, and then get to the weekend. And then, next thing you know, it's another week down, and just keep looking straight ahead. But
do you find it intimidating at all when you see the news and you see these, you know, pretty much these cops being made example of, and you know that you're going to be doing that within 6 months, you're going to be out there, you know, doing the job. Do you find it intimidating at all, that watching the news and knowing that could possibly be you?
Yeah, it's daunting, because to be quite honest with you, my actions can cause me to be put away in jail now. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, there's no longer that, that like, oh, you're an officer, we believe you 100%. That's just not going to fly. Excuse me. People are going to question everything you do. And it's that scary. It's like, man, if I fuck up just once, I can literally not only lose my job, but get into some serious financial issues, go to, you know, court for something, get locked up for years based on a decision that you made.
Yeah.
A routine traffic stop, there's no such thing as a routine traffic, but a traffic stop can literally possibly put you in jail, you know, based on your actions.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's just, it's very daunting. But I feel like if you keep thinking about, that, then it's going to really impair how you're going to be policing. Does that make sense?
Sure.
Because you can't really focus on that. Because before, this shit's always been around, right? No one's really heard of it. There's officers that probably are just douchebags, and, you know, they have a gun and a badge and feel like they ooze machismo, you know? It's just their thing. Like,
that's actually kind of like the stereotypical, you know, when people think of cops, they think of cops like doing that a lot. They don't picture the cop, you know, playing catch with a kid on the street. Do you know what I mean?
And they don't want to see that
either. I know.
Like, the narrative is not, they want to see the cop like actually do community policing and get involved in their community. Like, that's just like completely the opposite of what they're trying to, especially now. You know, no one wants to hear it. If you say anything, if you know, all those blue line flags and all that shit, like, people have bumper stickers, and those are, you're literally putting a damn target on your back.
Yeah.
And like, they, in our academy, people were taking pictures of our license plates, taking pictures of the cars coming in and out.
Wow.
There were people stationed outside. People were trying to get in. And if they found your car, like, let's say at a Walmart, and they knew you had a blue light flag, they would mark it with a highlighter. And people were, and this is just like shit that we heard from our, you know, our captains and lieutenants and shit, that like, just be careful, you know, make sure you wash your car, make sure you do all, because they're attracting people home.
Wow. Like,
yeah, and that's scary.
That's really scary.
Yeah, you're putting your family at risk because you're trying to help other families, and they don't see that because all they see is they think you're just going to destroy somebody or kill somebody because that's the narrative now.
Yeah.
You know? And they say, like, people get pissed off when they hear, like, 99% of the cops are good and you got a couple bad ones and this and that. I can speak for, like, my academy class. These guys are going to be some good fucking cops. Like, they're just going to be out there, you know, handling business and taking care of people. Like, right. They genuinely care about people. And it's, like, it's unfortunate, but just like anything, man, there's going to be some bad apples. I can't think of anything or any group that has everyone chimed in like they want to. You know what I mean?
Sure.
The military has these horrible people. Take it, for instance, that girl that got murdered in Texas, that she was in the, she disappeared.
Vanessa Guillen.
Yeah, bro. And then
it's a horrible story. You know, her unit and her command completely failed her, and it's incredibly unfortunate.
It's sickening, and it's the stories like that you hear, and it's like you don't want to hear it, right?
Right.
But now look how much flack the military is going to get.
Oh, the armies, and rightfully so, they should, because they completely dropped the ball on the whole thing.
Yeah, I mean, it's just crazy. It's just the stories like that. Like, you want everybody in line, but it's hard. You know, it's hard to keep people. You want everybody to say, like, all right, this is what you're gonna do. You're gonna be an outstanding citizen. This is gonna. I mean, you gotta walk it and talk it. You know.
Yeah.
But it's just a different age now, man. It's just the media, social media, everything grows so rapid, it happens so quick, you know, and everybody wants something like instantaneously, but they don't realize that no one's really working to help the situation out. You know what I mean? It's just like
somebody falls and someone's videotaping it and like the person needs medical attention.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and there's a lot of people that like, these cameras, I think it's so funny because they don't give you the whole video.
They don't.
Like, you know what I mean? You don't know what happened when you get involved in that. I've seen so many cop video, and I stopped watching it, man, because it messes with your head. Like, I've seen so many cop videos that, and I got a couple buddies there on YouTube. They call me YouTube famous, man. So you go in, they get a traffic stop, or something happens, they get called, and this guy's video only takes part of like the last 10 seconds of the whole arrest, you know, and that cop's like chastised forever for it, you know, because he had pants on or anything. And it's, I'm like, well, you didn't see that he beat the shit out of his two kids and, you know, ran over this dog and all this other stuff, you know, but you record the last 10 seconds and we're abusing him now. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's controlling the narrative, you know, of cops being bad guys, I guess, and everyone who gets pulled over is innocent, and you know they didn't do what you thought they were doing.
It's crazy. I saw that. I don't know if you heard that. Well, you saw the chop in Seattle.
Oh yeah, that was great. I saw a funny video somebody sent me of you know, somebody from there, and they were like, you know, things were going so well here, you know, and yet the place was like Mad Max, you know, it was like everybody for themselves. I think they had some rapper walking around charging businesses $500 for protection. He was like walking around with an AK-47 or something like that.
Well, yeah, people walk around with guns. People were like raping people, and then they're like, "Hey, things are getting it's a peaceful protest, and you know, this is not like Woodstock and the whole night."
Yeah.
And I'm like, "Okay," I was like, "Even if that's what you wanted, no police," and they let that happen, right?
Right.
Yeah, no police, nothing going on, and then all of a sudden, what happened? They try to develop their own.
Right.
Like
they adopted closed borders. Right. Small liberal state adopted closed borders really quickly.
Real quick. Right. So no one can come in. No one can leave. And all of a sudden it's like, all right, if you were going to start acting up in here, we're going to have to take guns. Right. So but they didn't take just any guns. They're walking around with AK-47s, AR. teens.
You know, they adopted closed borders, and they wanted armed security. You know, and it's like, hold on a second here. This is essentially, you know, like a poor man's version of a real city.
Yep. It was hilarious, like, because that's the epitome of what can happen in the nation if, you know, you defund police and if there's no law and order and people take it upon themselves to start policing themselves, even though they don't want to call it policing, you know. All of a sudden, people get shot, people get killed over, like, crazy things because there's no
cops.
Accountability. Yeah, there's no cops.
Listen to this. I don't know if you've heard about this, but the LASD has budget cuts. The LA County of Board of Supervisors voted slashing $145 million from the Sheriff's Department budget. The county approved a budget that would slash $453 million in county spending to make up for the $940 million budget shortfall, with the cuts spread across multiple departments. Okay, now this is what they're going to be. This is what's going to happen. The sheriff said that the $145 million that they're cutting is on top of the $400 million the sheriff department is already underfunded. Okay. Because of this, they're going to have to get rid of 345 LASD employees and cutting major activities like the Special Victims Bureau, which investigates crime involving children, rape, and human trafficking, Safe Streets Bureau, which is responsible for gang enforcement, the Fraud and Cyber Crimes Bureau, because there's no cyber crimes, right? And the Major Crimes Bureau. And these were the units that were recommended by the city councils to get rid of. Now, obviously, human trafficking is a huge problem that nobody ever talks about. The statistics are staggering, okay? Nobody ever talks about them, but it's something that needs to be addressed. Obviously, there's no gang problems in LA, right? So let's just cut the gang unit because they're not doing anything. There's no cyber crimes, you know. There's no such thing as cyber crimes, and the Special Victims Bureau, which investigates children and rape, you know.
Yeah, that doesn't happen.
This is unbelievable, and I don't know where the thinking is. Wanting to cut these kinds of programs, you know, out of everything that needs to be cut, you know, they're going to cut this kind of stuff. Now, how about this? Let me ask you a question. Do you think that it would be more feasible to cut, say, you know, patrolling the freeway than cutting things like major crimes?
I mean, yeah, no. I mean, you still need, like, I feel like it's a catch 22 because you still need that enforcement on the roads. I mean, because what people keep missing is, like, these departments are there to protect people, right? So it doesn't matter if it's traffic enforcement or if it's, you know, a major crimes unit, you know, like it's the same thing. Ultimately, it's there to protect, you know, human life. You know, that's, you know, everybody talks about the sanctity of life. Blah, blah, blah. But if I don't stop somebody going at 100 miles an hour on the freeway and puts a family of, you know, hits a minivan and crushes mom, dad, and her, you know, there's six kids.
Yeah.
It's the same. It's equally as bad as, you know, somebody a major crimes unit that's investigating a guy that's been constantly, you know, seeking children. You know what I mean? You can't, you defund one. There's no transfer of police. You can't just cut it. Like, to me, it's a slippery slope, right? So let's say you do cut that. You cut, you know, people don't think, yeah, traffic for it. Don't stop me for doing that. Okay, I understand that. A good portion of people, you know, don't really break the law. But if you know that the enforcement's not going to be there anymore, how likely are you to
break the law?
Kind of. Yeah, you know, just apply and just say, fuck it, I'm going to keep going. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So how much more risk is everybody at now if you do that? Just like when they're cutting down major crimes, all that. I mean, that shit's crazy to me. crazy because no one wants to hear or see the batshit crazy things that people do. Like, we had Major Crimes Unit come out, Death Scene, Crime Scene, just like all these special victims units. We had we have a human trafficking unit as well. They came out and talked to us, and that's a huge problem that no one talks about. It. That's actually really scary. And it's just, it's nuts to just even think about what they have to face and these little units that take care of big problems like that. And to just say, hey, you know what, you guys, we can't afford you guys anymore. You know, they don't want us doing this anymore. Good luck. Society will work
itself. It'll fix itself.
Yeah, it'll fix itself. There, you don't need that, you know. And then next thing you know, Timmy's on TikTok, you know, talking to a 40-year-old man saying, hey, let's meet up somewhere.
Right. New York is also, they're cutting $1 billion from the NYPD's budget.
Dude, New York is, that place is New York, Chicago, LA. I hate to say it, man, but those guys, they bring it on themselves. They really do. They genuinely, they want to appease the very few just to make a statement, just to say, hey, you know what? We're taking care of this, right? But they don't really think about their actions. So that's the scary part. You know, you have a shit ton of shootings in Chicago, a shit ton. And then they want to go after, you know, guns and, you know, restricting and all that. But they failed to realize that the people that have guns are going to get guns no matter what.
Yeah. You know, that's the problem. You know, it's like, so I got an idea. We're gonna impose incredibly strict gun laws that are gonna prevent the average citizen from making it harder for them to get weapons. But yeah, the guys who are walking by killing kids and doing walk bys and drive bys, they're not going to Cabela's to go and buy a to go buy a Glock. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. They're getting it from somewhere else.
Those serial numbers are scratched off and
yeah.
No one really gives a shit. Like, and for New York and all of them to be like, all right, we're defunding the police. I think it's just a statement for the public so they feel like, hey, yeah, we're going to do this. But they don't really think about the actions behind it. I just think they're just doing
or solving the problem.
Just to play to the narrative. Like, hey, look, this is what we're doing. Like, good job, asshole. So now when you're walking down the street in New York, I feel 10 times safer.
Yeah. Yeah, it's what we're going to do is we're going to put less cops on the street, okay? So you're pretty much on your own, but we're also going to give you such strict gun laws that you won't be able even be able to defend yourself.
There's no way.
And since there aren't as many cops to put out on the street, the cops that we do have are going to be even more stressed out. It sounds like a recipe that's going to work.
You know, if you do, I think they should just go back to like the 1900s. If you need help, just blow a whistle. Yeah. hope to God somebody comes and helps.
Yeah, maybe we'll be there. You know.
Yeah, if it happens, if I'm within ear blast of it, and I happen to locate you, maybe I might help. But you know,
I think that even like now more than ever, man, it's important for people to understand that they're their own first response. You know, that they're the ones that are going to kind of help themselves in a way. I'm not saying taking the law into your own hands. I'm talking about, you know, doing a, you know, like a Red Cross class and knowing first aid, CPR and AED and utilizing your Second Amendment rights because everybody has them, you know?
Yeah. Yo, I don't know if you probably know this, but like I have a Cabela's nearby me and, I went there. I forgot what I was going to get. But as soon as I walked in, the shit was empty.
Really?
Empty. Line for guns was out the fucking door. And I'm in there, and I'm like, this is what it's causing chaos. Yeah. Like, the people, I mean, it's average citizens now, you know, the narrative is forcing people to say, hey, you know what? If they do defund the police, if they do take away, you know, this and I, you know, they call it the thin blue line and how it protects everybody, but you know, it's really if they take away that, people aren't, they're not going to feel safe anymore. And I guarantee you that's making society even more tense, where someone who has no training whatsoever, that's just scared, is going to pull that trigger, and more people are going to end up getting hurt by it. If they would have just said, hey, this was a horrible, horrible, horrific accident, we're going to take action on this officer. You know, I think the charges fit because of the severity of it. And then left it at that instead of like this huge movement. And I get it. It became a racial thing, right? Which it is what it is, right? But I feel like if you're going to go back to the action of it, then go to everyone that had that happen. Because there's plenty of white people that died. There's plenty of Hispanics that have died. There's plenty of, you know, people that have died because of an officer.
Yeah.
You know? And it shouldn't be about race. It should be about the action, right?
It should be about bad cops. Not you know, one specific demographic of people. I understand. I mean, there are some social injustices for people, but I don't even want to get into that because that's probably like another hour conversation. Okay.
No, I 100% agree with that. But it's just, I mean, it's making the right now, I feel like society is scared.
Yeah.
And now that they're scared and they're taken away, or they're seeing their local government saying, yeah, we're probably going to defund the police, and really don't have a solution to how they're going to handle the society in case shit pops off. They're kind of putting it in their citizens' hands, right? So that's why you see the line at Cabela's.
I'm pretty happy to hear that there are more people taking advantage of their Second Amendment rights. That being said, I highly suggest that if you're listening to this and you are a new gun owner, first off, your gun should always be in its holster. Wherever it is, it should always be inside of a holster. It's something that I strongly believe in. And next, you need to get some training. You need to go out and get some kind of training. Shoot Point Blank is a pretty well-known, pretty big, I would say, like range type of company, indoor shooting range type of company. They have classes. I highly suggest whatever you do is get some kind of training.
Yeah, firearm training.
And med.
Yeah, if you go and just buy a pistol and you think that's just the end all and that's it.
It's not.
It's really a lot more than that. Yeah, it's you got to be able to be comfortable with it. You got to be able to put 1,000 rounds and figure out what happens when shit goes wrong, you know, because it is a tool. Sometimes your tool fucks up. You know, how do you fix that? How do you correct that? And then, you know, you got to be ready, willing, and able.
Well, if you have a Glock, you shouldn't have those issues. But it's not about the bow and arrow. It's about the Indian. You know, it doesn't matter what kind of gun you have. It's more about you.
Yeah, and people, like I said, that's the big thing. You got to be ready, willing, and able to kill somebody, right? Like, that's ultimately the goal. It's not to wound somebody. It's not to maim somebody. It's not to back somebody off. When you have that, that is the ultimately last resort. You keep it in the holster. You break leather. You better make sure that you have the mental capacity to handle that.
Oh,
to be able to handle a stressful situation, you know, and have the mental fortitude to be like, okay, this is the decision I'm going to make.
Right.
I'm going to have to live with that right now.
Right.
So are we doing this or not?
Right. And
yeah, so that's where it comes to training, man. 100% goes to training.
And I highly suggest that you don't use leather holsters. You use Kydex. So, in closing, Los, we'll do another one of these maybe 6 months down the road after you've, you know, cut your teeth out on the street and had some time doing the job. But in closing, do you have anything that you want to say?
You know what? To be honest, I think what we discussed kind of just puts everything out there. I do want everybody to believe that, or I guess take away the fact that there's a lot of people that really want to do the job and really want to be out there to help people. It's really not about the power. It's about being able to really provide a good service and keep everything in line. There's rules and regulations there for a reason. And police officers really, for the majority that I can speak of that I've come in contact with, they just really want to do a good job and make sure everybody's safe. You know, that's kind of what it comes down to. There's really not much more to it than that. I got into this because it's something I've always wanted to do, and I want to put my fingerprint out there and help society. And now more than ever, I feel like if you want to make a difference in policing and you feel like there's an injustice, that they're hiring, man. They're hiring, and they're hiring a lot of people. And if you feel like you can handle that and you want to make a change in society, apply, sign up, start your local, you know, law enforcement, and, you know, make policing yours. It really comes down to the people that they get in there. So that's pretty much how I see law enforcement now. I think it's a trend that I hope changes soon, that I hope everybody kind of gets a good, I want them to get a good taste of, like, law enforcement. You know, that's the biggest thing. And it really comes down to the people and really the officers you meet. Talk to them, man. Find out why they got into it, what they're doing, what was their best experience, what's their worst experience. A lot of the times the guys that are out there, man, they just probably came off a horrible call that you can't even think of. And they might be shitty and salty because they've seen kids dead. They've seen, family members torn apart by, you know, we're there on that person's worst day. You don't see a police officer on a good day. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's not like, hey, how's it going, officer? It's probably the worst day of their lives. And to be able to, I guess, help them through it or be the beginning process of a good situation really comes down to the officer. So, like I said, right now, difficult times. I can't speak for everybody, but I mean, if you want to make a difference, always apply. I know they're looking, and, you know, that's pretty much it, man. There's really not much more of that. I appreciate you having me on.
Yeah, no problem.
We'll definitely get together soon on a personal note, and, you know, do this again. Go from there.
Yeah, and I think I speak for everyone out there. Do not, if you know a scumbag cop, don't let him just hide in the cracks. You know, let him know about it, or let somebody know about it, so that, you know, these guys aren't walking around and they don't ruin it for the good cops.
Sure.
All right, brother. Well, you take care of yourself, man. Thank you for being on the show. That's all we got for you tonight, guys. Everybody, take it easy. Jeffrey Epstein didn't kill himself. This is Pre out.